Here we are in Switzerland at the ICO conference. I'm talking to Charles Hodgkinson from Input Output. And I, first disclosure, I own a bunch of ADA. And it's been them doing very well, especially in the beginning.
It depends on who you ask.
Yeah, no, but I mean, I bought it early enough. So, anyway, you had a talk about the third generation of blockchains, sure. And you've been involved with Ethereum. And if people want to know that, you have to learn to listen to the talk. But why, I first want to go to your personal story. Why did you get interested in this space and to travel around the world 200 days a year and share all these things?
Yeah, so I started in the, well, before I even started in the cryptocurrency space, I was a mathematician. And so I never thought I was actually going to be an entrepreneur. I thought maybe I'd just go be a
public speaker.
Or a public speaker, right. Well, I love teaching, so that's kind of like public speaking, yeah. Right? Just a much smaller, more intimate audience. But I also loved monetary policy and finance. I worked on the Ron Paul campaign back in 2008. So that's where I learned about Murray Rothbard and Hayek and Ludwig von Mises and so forth and private currencies. And I said, wow, you know, this idea that you don't actually have to have the dollar living in America, you could have competing currencies and standards was always appealing. But there really was no competition, right? If you went and created your own money, you get thrown in jail.
Some gold coins have tried that.
Right. And the Ron Paul dollar and the Liberty dollar and so forth, they haven't fared so well. And so when Bitcoin came out, it was kind of an amalgamation of many things that I was really passionate about. Like I love the technology side of it. I love the culture side of it. I'm kind of a cypherpunk myself.
What did you do at that time?
Well, I was still a mathematician at the time.
You worked on the university or something?
I was a graduate student at the time. And so it came out and I was like, oh, this is really interesting stuff. So I kind of ignored it though, because I said, well, the only reason money works is because people believe in it. So it's not about the technology, it's not about the vision, it's about adoption. So you need to get past a certain threshold, and once you get past that threshold, then it's a real thing, you're really viable. Mm-hmm. So when I saw that happening, I realized that this industry is not only here to stay, it's going to change the entire world. And it's not going to just change money, it's going to change everything. It's going to change commercial relationships, it's going to change property rights, the way we identify each other, the way we handle reputation, it's going to change democracy, it's going to change the nature of the firm.
Everything,
right? The whole banana.
This was 2000.
This was around 2013. Yeah. So I bought Bitcoin. I'd mined some Bitcoin. I'd known that prior to that, but it was always a curiosity rather than a passion. And then around 2013, I said, okay, this is here to stay. So having no entrepreneurial experience, no skills, I went to my professor Carl Gustafson, and I said, Carl, what should I do? And he said, well, Charles, those who cannot do teach. And I said, that's a good idea.
That's what I say as a trend watcher, yeah.
There you go, right? Go teach somebody and then somehow it'll work out. So that's exactly what I did. I created the Bitcoin Education Project and I just said, what is money? What is monetary policy? What is Bitcoin? And I released a bunch of free content online. And the flagship class we released was called Bitcoin or How I Learned to Stop Worrying and Love Crypto. And because I'm a Peter Sellers fan, you know, Dr. Strangelove. So I released it. I ended up getting over 70,000 students. And I got a chance to meet everybody, like Andreas Antonopoulos and Adam Levine and all the big guys, even John Matonis and so forth. So from there, I was able to bootstrap that into starting my very first business, which was called Invictus Innovations. And I worked with, of all people, Dan Larimer. It was a unique partnership that was short-lived. And we created BitShares. And I learned a heck of a lot. And actually, BitShares came from asking my students. I had on Bitcoin Talk, I had this thing called Project Invictus. And I was saying, like, what would make blockchain tech or Bitcoin or crypto invincible, make it undefeatable against governments or outside actors? They say, well, if you can create a stable coin and you can create a decentralized exchange, you don't need banks anymore because you don't need exchanges, you don't need banks, you don't need them for credit. It's just going to run and work on its own devices.
Same like the MP3 world.
Exactly, right? It's like that is the market. So we said, let's go try to do that. So BitShares didn't quite accomplish what we wanted, but it did start the conversation. And since that time, there's been a lot of people talking about decentralized exchange and so forth. The other thing was just I learned how difficult it was to actually build a cryptocurrency. And I suffered the same thing Vitalik suffered and everybody else suffered, which was the frustration of changing things. Every single time you set a decision, by design, it's hard to undo that decision. So if you make a mistake, you can't correct the mistake. Or if you want to add functionality, it's a very difficult matter. So he said, God, it'd be so nice if we just had a programming language connected to a blockchain. And then suddenly everything.
What a natural idea,
right?
Yeah.
It's like when JavaScript came to the web browser. That's what gave you Netflix, and that's what gave you Gmail and Facebook and all these things, right? It wasn't Mozilla or Google deciding, boy, let's create Netflix functionality into Chrome. You know, it was you, the author of that content or that platform writing software. So similarly, if you can model financial relationships or business relationships in a way that are that have the same properties as a cryptocurrency, we felt that would be valuable.
And that was the start of the Ethereum group of people. When that was that first group of people getting together?
Yeah, so it was kind of an aggregation of a lot of different people, and some of which should have been in the core group, and some, and for whatever reason just didn't work out, or in others just kind of their way in. But basically, it started at around October, I'd say September, October of 2013. And really...
Where was it?
So it was decentralized. So Vitalik was working on Color Coins and Mastercoin, and he was working with the same set of problems we had with BitShares, where he said, God, it's so hard to actually
do anything on that damn Bitcoin blockchain.
Right. So he said, God, if only I had something like Python or JavaScript, you know, it would be great. So he started writing a paper that was basically an overlay protocol on top of Primecoin. So it wasn't even its own standalone cryptocurrency. It's kind of like similar to Rootstock in its design now. At the same time, a few months earlier, Sergio Lerner, who's now the CTO of Rootstock, actually came up with the concept of like a blockchain-based smart contract. And he even came up with an idea of launching a coin and everything. But they never exercised it. They never did it. And then, you know, we had our own things at BitShares. We came up with the idea of the DAC, the Decentralized Autonomous Company. That was Stan Larimer.
That was your idea? That was your term?
Yeah, it was Stan Larimer. He wrote the very first article on it, like the Bitcoin and the Three Laws of Robotics or something like that. It was a Bitcoin Magazine article. And we defined kind of like what an unmanned company would look like. Dan's father, Stan, spent 40 years in the drone space. He worked at SAIC. So he designed all these unmanned vehicles, and he was a big sci-fi buff, always reading Arthur C. Clarke and, you know, these other guys. And so as a result, he was always able to imagine, like, how could we play with these things?
What was the first meeting? It was an online meeting, or it was an email list, or?
I'll tell you. So what happened was that I'd been doing some educational stuff with the Bitcoin Alliance of Canada with Anthony DiOrio. And Anthony knew Vitalik through Bitcoin Decentral. And that's the meetup group that Vitalik would go, because at the time he was living in Toronto. So Vitalik, Mihai was the co-founder of Bitcoin Magazine with Vitalik. They started it together. Amir Chitrit and Anthony were all having meetings. And then Anthony brought me in as kind of like a technical due diligence. And he said, hey, you read the paper and tell us what you think. And that was around maybe November of 2013. So I came in and I said, well, it's really interesting, but maybe we need to standalone this, and you know, this looks a little crazy and so forth. And so we had those conversations. Right around the same time, Vitalik opened up a Skype group and invited lots of people into a Skype channel. And that's where we met Gavin Wood and Jeff Wilchie and so forth. And then Anthony knew Joe Lubin from Toronto. Joe was doing something up there at that time. So we just said, you know, we all need to meet each other. So let's go rent some beach house somewhere at some conference and come together. And
it was a physical meeting at last, yeah.
And that was at the North American Bitcoin Conference back in January of 2014. So Anthony DiOrio rented the beach house. We all flew down there. Jeff wasn't able to make it. Gavin did come. Mihai couldn't come because of a visa issue. He's Romanian. He couldn't get a visa into the United States. And we all just kind of met each other. There's about 30 people at that beach house. And that's where functionally Ethereum, the entity, was born. And then we had to figure out, well, like, how are we going to structure it? How are we going to raise money? How are we actually going to build the venture and so forth? And, you know, the rest is history, and it goes through.
Who came up with the first money to basically pay for the basic goods?
Two people. So Joe put in some money and Anthony put in some money. And so all the European operations were covered by Joe and the North American operations were covered by Anthony. And it wasn't very much. It was like $250,000, you know. And so
but a $250,000 makes it happen.
Right? You know, we were like, whoa, this is of a lot of money, and now like everybody's raising $1 billion, so they're $250,000. I spent that much on caviar or something like that.
Now, you talk always about you know, the biggest problems with the blockchains and the first generation, the second generation, the Ethereum, and the third generation, you know, to make it scalable, governance, and to have a system which is actually practical. When did Ethereum, the group of Ethereum and that nice group of beach people, when did that fell apart? Or when did you say, hey, it's time for me to go because I need to do it a different way?
I left quite early on. So there was kind
you
of...
made it come to Switzerland, right? You said that Ethereum, being, we are here in Switzerland. We're in Zurich and...
Yeah, I lived in Zug with Mihai and a few of the other Ethereum people. Yeah. And it was just down the street. So there was two sides to the Ethereum group. There was the business side and there was the dev side. And so the business side was Amir Chetrit and Anthony and Joe and Mihai. And then the dev side was Jeff and Gavin and Vitalik. And then I kind of sat in the middle. I was like the CEO, basically, but in name only. I didn't really have a lot of CEO power. And I was kind of just holding everything together. And we had to kind of make a decision. Should we go for profit like Ripple, or should we go not for profit Foundation and do this whole setup? So my argument was, let's do for profit, kind of like Ripple, take VC money. We had some offers in the Valley, and let's go build the protocol, get the whole thing finished, and then set up an independent foundation, have that foundation run a crowd sale with a separate board, and they can retain the for profit entity to continue development and maintenance and upgrades and so forth.
Trevor's does the same.
This is like a more common model now, but at the time it was very revolutionary, right? And my principal argument was that, number one, the project had grown too big. We had like 50 people, 100 people, and it was mostly transitive. So people would bring their friends in and so forth. And it wasn't clear who the relationships were. And, you know, and this was mostly volunteer, but everybody had an expectation of getting some ether or something like that. So there was not a lot of organizational discipline, and we didn't have the mandate to enforce
it. You as a CEO were running that big elephant going in every direction.
Well, I couldn't do anything. I mean, we had a committee of 8 people, and basically every meeting was just painful. We couldn't even figure out a pre-mine, for God's sakes. It was so horrible. So I said, let's do a for-profit, build a board, get some adult supervision, centralize the company in a place like Switzerland, go build it all up, and then once we've built it all up, we'd be in a position to go and do a fundraising event. And we'd already set up all the legal work that we felt that event could be fine. Now, Vitalik didn't want to do that. He said, well, you know, let's do a not-for-profit, it'll ruin the core of the project. My argument was that we would have no incentive to stay. Everybody would just simply leave because they're being paid up front, and there's nothing materially connecting them to a foundation. But anyway, he went with the foundation. The business side kind of fractured. Amir immediately left. I left. And this was in June of 2014, so early on. And then eventually Joe went and created Consensus, and Anthony went and created Decentral and Jax and all these projects. And then Gavin went and created his own company and so forth. So it ended up fracturing anyway, very naturally. But they shipped, and they shipped a great product, and the market seems to like it. It still has a lot of challenges, and they're trying to...
Thanks for the initial coin offering. It's a big success, right? Did you ever think that that platform would be used as a major use, except for CryptoKitties, for that purpose?
Right, as an investment bank in the sky. It was in the original white paper, and we had that discussion. Yeah, for decentralized fundraising, because MasterCoin had happened, right? And we were aware that you could do that, and we wanted to have better ways of doing it. So we were aware that that would be a use case, but it was like a paragraph or two in the original white paper. It wasn't a big thing. We didn't imagine that that would become the majority use case of Ethereum, for at least for the time being. But we also did know that Ethereum's business logic is really expensive to run, you know, code on Ethereum. So we never imagined it would be used as like a replacement for Rackspace or Amazon until we found a way to scale, right? So there's only a collection of applications that would really run well. And of them, the ICO seems to be the application that runs really, really well on Ethereum for the time being.
How do you think Ethereum is doing now? I mean, with the governments, with the scalability, with the security, with how do you think it's the state of it is now?
Well, it's easy to criticize because I know all the things I would do differently if I was still there. I mean, we're kind of seeing that roll out with the Cardano project. But, you know, at the end of the day, they're still one of the largest and most successful cryptocurrencies in the world. Vitalik is a great brand representative, and he does a lot of good.
Did he scale?
No, he doesn't scale yet, but no one scales yet. So it's
no. Does he scale as a person? You know, because you met him when he was 19 years old,
oh,
I think.
Yeah.
And
has he grown
as a person? Does he scale?
Tremendously. He's one of the smartest guys in the space, and he's grown a heck of a lot as a businessman. I mean, when you start with no knowledge, 19 years old, being handed a multi-billion-dollar ecosystem and say, go have fun with that. There's only a few people alive that have been able to handle that fairly well. I mean, even Steve Jobs was fired first time around, right? So the fact that he's been able to accomplish as much as he has is truly remarkable. And it's just a testament to his character and to his technical skills and to his capabilities as a leader. So, and his ecosystem loves him. They really do. Don't like me so much, but that's okay.
Well, you've been a little critical from time to time, but you've also been full of praise. So, let's finish on Ether and of Ethereum and then go to Cardona. What do you think the future of Ethereum is? I mean, in terms of your governance, your scalability, etc.
Okay, so the big challenge for Ethereum is going to be how are they going to transition from proof of work to a from a replicated system to a multi-blockchain proof of stake system and handle that transition. It's the single greatest potential challenge for the platform. And they have some ideas like Casper and Plasma, and they have some allies and so forth. The other thing is they have to be a thought leader in the smart contract model. And so it's become very clear that smart contracts aren't as good as we claim them to be. The developer experience is terrible. They're not as reliable in terms of the code.
Fantastic bugs.
Right. But that's to be expected because no one with strong PL background actually was involved the first time around when they were designing these things. So there's a movement towards formalization. There's a movement towards better language design. There's a movement towards better virtual machine design, like they're going to switch from the EVM to WebAssembly and so forth. So there's a lot of these things that they have to accomplish. That's a tall order, but they have the money and they have the people to do it. So the next 2 years is just managing upgrades to the system and hoping the upgrades don't destroy the system. Then after that occurs, managing growth, because if it really does what they claim it's going to do, they'll have 1 billion users, right? And so how do you manage an ecosystem with 1 billion users? So the existential long-term crisis to Ethereum is governance. And you can't have just one person at the top. He'll get killed or arrested or eventually retire. So you need to figure out how do you federate and who's in charge and how are you going to be in charge? And that's probably the single most difficult problem. It's a social problem instead of a technological one.
So that was Ethereum. Next chapter is we talk about how to do it different, how to build it from scratch, do it the right way, do it in a nice governance system, scalable, and also interoperability. And that's next interview.